but do it funnier.
Welcome back to the Old Rope Salvage Workshop in deepest Cornwall. I'm Lisa, he's Tim. What are we doing here again?
Well, we are currently restoring, rebuilding a 1975 Bedford ex-airfield crash tender or fire truck. We are restoring the truck first and then we shall be building our little home, our palace on the back. It's a really exciting project for us. We're learning many things as we go along. We're both artists, we're not car builders. We're hoping to learn all sorts of new skills as we go and sharing what we learn with you, our little audience there. Our little audience.
We have got a little audience, it's a tiny audience. Hi mum.
Yeah, so what are we doing on this video?
So if you're new here, this video is a recap of everything that we've done over the last few months, which is basically the restoration of the cab of our Bedford truck. So you can either stick around today and watch it all in 20 minutes and be up to speed, or you can go back and watch every one of our videos, which documents the progress, the process in greater details. If you're not new here and you're one of our regular subscribers, oh, it's a little treat for you. You get to live it all over again. Well, we have a little break from filming this week.
Yeah, we're just giving ourselves a bit of time off because from filming anyway. But the
not from anything else.
No, everything else is still going on. We've been fitting some insulation and some soundproofing into the truck. I'm currently working on trying to fathom the headlining. All sorts of other bits and pieces we're trying to work out. But they will come to you very shortly because, well, I haven't filmed it. Should be I filmed it? Oh, anyway, you'll get to see that soon.
Yeah, we've had a bit of a massive cleanup of the workshop and a bit of a rearrangement before we start the next big phase of the restoration, which will be sort of back to sandblasting and stuff. But we are waiting on the installation of the long anticipated electricity supply, which should be coming to a barn near us any day now.
Yeah.
So we really need the electricity in now before we can really crack on with the next stage of work. So keep your fingers crossed that in the next video we'll have some positive news about that.
Yeah, in the meantime, enjoy this 20 minutes of your time, which was many months of our time, in a little recap video.
Yeah, roll the film.
And see you soon.
See you soon. The cab was delivered, conveniently along with the rest of the truck, on the back of a really massive lorry at the end of 2020. First impressions were favourable, as it looked quite compact sitting there on the back of that huge truck. So we got it inside our new rented workshop, and tried very hard not to feel too overwhelmed at the project we had, for some unfathomable reason, willingly given ourselves.
The bleeding knuckles commence.
Our new old Bedford is a former fire truck built in 1975. The cab is actually the same as those found on the more familiar Bedford TKs, which have often been used for self-build camper conversions. But we wanted something a little older and a little tougher for our adventure mobile, which is where our slightly bigger four-wheel drive MK comes in.
Hold on!
Are you a bit excited?
I'm a bit excited.
Yes, it was all high spirits indeed when we started dismantling the cab in the spring of 2021.
Oh, he's a hole!
The first piece has been removed. We had decided that we wanted to do a full restoration on this old Bedford, as the plan was to eventually turn her into our home, as well as a go-anywhere overlander. And although she wasn't in a terrible state, Close inspection revealed a number of areas of rust and disrepair.
Some bits missing.
So we started by taking the whole cab apart. Every panel, every wing, the doors.
Yes, sir, I can do it. I'll struggle away with this.
All the windows and the trims. Every last nut and bolt, even the old fire stickers. It made quite the rusty pile on our workbench. And it was apparent at the start that this was going to be a steep learning curve for, well, one of us at least.
Lefty loosey, righty tighty.
We had a giggle. All of this culminated on the day we removed the cab from the chassis, a delicate but also somewhat heavy operation involving a block and tackle, a fortuitously placed iron beam, a bit of ingenuity and some elbow grease. And with the cab bolted onto a movable frame on wheels, we were almost ready to begin the restoration. So there only remained the internal gubbins to remove from the cab at this point, all the electrics, the wiring loom, the dashboard panels, pedals, and most tricky of all, the steering column. But it came out eventually, and then we were left with the bare shell of the cab, which meant only one thing: it was time to get the scrapers out.
Get your overalls on!
At this point, we already had the intention of using a grinder and the sandblaster to get the cab right down to bare metal. But with our limited resources and an ongoing lack of mains electricity, a whole other saga deserving of its very own story, we started out with some good old-fashioned paint scraping, aided by regular brews.
You just turned up to work with that building's first job on the agenda.
It wasn't as labour-intensive as it looks, as the old paint came off cleanly and easily with the scrapers, and we were able to take it back to the original primer, where it would remain until the better weather days in the summer. Although it is fair to say that Tim did become slightly obsessed. Being a perfectionist also means remembering when to stop. After scraping off most of the paint and the underseal, we could get a closer look at what we were dealing with, and it wasn't pretty. Areas of rust, corrosion, and holes like Swiss cheese were everywhere, particularly on the floors and the sills and around the back of the parcel shelf. So it was evident from the start that we, well, I say we, but I mean Tim, would be making up a number of replacement panels. So, armed with some sheet steel, Tim set about creating patterns with old cereal boxes and fabricating the new pieces.
An hour condensed down into a couple of minutes.
All of this took several weeks, but he did find a bit of time to give me a couple of welding lessons, which I put to good use, of course.
Alright, you've just taken two bits of metal and you've ruined both of them. You can have your bronze welding badge.
So finally, we welded up the 41 holes in the roof, which had been left in there after all the firefighting equipment had been removed. And then the cab was rust-free once again, and ready
for some serious sandblasting. I was firing, she was gasoline. Creating a space in our workshop for some pretty heavy-duty sandblasting was always going to be a challenge, and we started out by experimenting with a DIY vapour blasting kit, which Tim rigged up using a couple of hoses connected to a bucket of sandy water and a compressor, with an old bilge pump from a boat as an on-off switch.
What we've got to do now is put the glass in there and see if this actually does anything. The idea is that this comes out at such a force that it will strip paint and rust off stuff. Normally now we'd be doing this in a big cabinet, but we haven't got one, so at the minute we've got a bucket. If this works, hopefully that means we can get this outside and strip paint off it.
It was classic Mad Inventor stuff from Tim, and it did work in principle.
Got potential.
But in practice, it was messy and impractical, and not as effective as we might have hoped. So in the end, we reverted to dry blasting, and we invested in a hopper to hold the sand.
What we need is a big spray booth. We need something.
Lisa's comfort centre.
She won't know.
We saw a load of sand in this tent.
This worked brilliantly, but our next challenge was building some kind of tent inside the workshop to contain the inevitable mess. Cheapskates that we are, tent Mark 1 was a flimsy affair, but it was summer and we were optimistic.
Yeah, one false move of a spray gun or sandblaster and...
Well, the cling film tent, RIP, lasted long enough for Tim to finish grinding the cab down to the shiny bare metal. A dirty, arduous task, which gave spectacular results, but which left the cab at its most vulnerable to flash rusting in our damp and unpredictable Cornish climate. And sure enough, just a few days after our first successful round of sandblasting, we were hit by a massive summer storm, which sadly left Temp Mark 1 in tatters.
The wind blew from over there, and I opened the doors, and the wind removed the tent. One step forward, three steps back. There we go.
It looks like we're going to be building another tent.
We were always up against it when it came to the weather, and we always will be. When it's dry and sunny, it's often very windy, and when it's not windy, it's raining or foggy, or it's everything at once. We've also had to work with the doors wide open because of the lack of lighting, which often leaves us battling the elements. But what can you do except rebuild better? And that's what we did. We dug into our pockets and bought ourselves some heavy-duty tarpaulins, and together with a borrowed gazebo frame, we were able to build Temp Mark 2, a construction which has been serving us well through all the weathers ever since. With all of our sandblasting infrastructure now working as well as we could possibly hope for, the process of cleaning up the cab became a fairly simple, if labour-intensive and incredibly messy task. Layers of protection for us meant sweating in the summer humidity under respirators, goggles, hats and gloves, anything we could muster really to stop the sand from getting into, well, everywhere, quite bluntly. But we were loving the results, which left us with an absolutely pristine cab, free from any residual rust spots and with a lovely even surface on which we could begin to apply the first layers of primer. First of all though...
got some cleaning to do now. It's grey.
We were really excited to have finally reached the stage where we could begin applying some paint. Tim had done quite a bit of research into the various paint systems available to us, and we cover this in quite a bit of detail in our earlier videos. But we started with an epoxy primer, and it didn't take long for Tim to spot the first flaw in his plan.
Still a few lumps left in there. Join me next week when I'll be making a cheesecake. It looks like I only have 3 holes. Brilliant.
Don't worry. I won't you push for any more of this. I'll mix it and then come back when I've finished that.
See you in the booth!
With the extensive stirring out of the way, the actual paint application was straightforward enough, and the transformation was instant. We were quite relieved to have the cab out of the bare metal, as even a few days' exposure to the damp weather was creating rust blooms, and after all that sandblasting, we weren't too keen on watching all the hard work go to waste. Still, we got there in the end, making sure every last crevice was sealed in and protected. The cab looked mighty fine for about 5 minutes. And then what did we do? Good. She was way past good. She was really we started messing it all up again, good, of course. Good. When it comes to restoration work, there is nothing I dislike more than sanding by hand. It's slow, boring, and it makes everything look a bit rubbish.
I sound like a complete
sleeper. It's like, I've basically done none of this. This is it. I'm like, I come in this morning, I'm like, oh, do you want me to help? 7.5 minutes later, oh, is it lunchtime yet?
To be fair to Tim, I did do a lot of grumbling during this time, and not a great deal of sanding. But what we did do was essential to give the epoxy primer a key for the next round of painting.
It's faster. Like, put yourself back on time lapse. You could probably do it in a couple of days.
Hey.
Tim also spent absolutely ages applying filler to the areas of the cab, particularly the roof, which were dented and uneven, sanding the filler back carefully using guide coats until the surface was perfectly even again. He also used fiberglass to fill small areas of pitting, which had been left by the rust we'd removed during the sandblasting. And finally, he applied sealer to the interior seams. With everything sanded, fillered, sealed and sanded. Did I say sanded? I meant sanded. Another layer of epoxy primer was applied and, oh yes, sanded.
Someone should invent a machine that does this for you. Like an electric sanding machine.
And then it was time to apply the High Build primer. High Build is essentially another filler, a really thick paint designed to fill any small imperfections still left behind before the top coat can go on. There would be more sanding after this, but well, you get the idea. Then miraculously we were ready for the top coat. We started with the roof, which we decided to paint in Old English white. Armed with a new spray gun and a whole load of nerves about messing it up, Tim balanced the cab at a right old precarious angle and set about applying the paint. And how wonderful it looked too. Stage one of the top coat was deemed a massive success. Of course, Before we could get on and paint the rest of it, there was still some last stage prep to do, namely some wet sanding to get the surface as perfect as was possible in our less than perfect setup.
We're a little bit anxious this morning, aren't we?
We had some right last minute ditherings over our colour choices as well, almost changing our minds from the colour we had decided on from the beginning.
It's the only colour that's known to devalue a car.
But we took some deep breaths and went ahead with it. And there it was, pretty glorious in all that shiny brown. But I mean, who paints their car brown? Well, apparently, we do.
Looks marvellous! It's so shiny!
With all our doubts dispelled by that delicious colour, there was just the exterior left. We spent some time masking off all the areas Tim had already painted, as nothing ruins a lovely paint job more effectively than overspray. And then we were able to finish the restoration of the cab, the task we had started back in the early spring, which we had somehow accomplished without Mains Electric and only with the most rudimentary of circumstances. And also just in time before the colder weather kicked in a few days later, which would have made painting impossible. Unmasking the cab and seeing it completed for the first time was a pretty good day for us.
I think we should get all the plastic off of this. Do a little bit of an unveiling.
We really love the results. And although it's just the first stage completed of this big ongoing project, we are hoping, in our usual naively optimistic way, that things might get a bit easier for us over the next year. And we are really looking forward to cracking on. Who knows, we might even finish the rest of it someday. Thanks for watching and for all the love and support, and we'll be seeing you back here again at the Old Rope Salvage Workshop very soon.